Ready?
All right. I call the Dacono City Council Monday, June 10, 2013. City Council meeting to order and request a roll call, please.
Jen Schneider.
Here.
Kevin Plain.
Here.
Joe Baker.
Here.
Peggy Randolph.
Present.
Steve Bruno.
Here.
Charles Sigmund.
Present. We have a quorum established and ask those in the audience to join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you. Well, it looks like we have a update from Mountain View Fire Protection. Chief Wiley is here to give it to us.
Mr. Mayor, Council, thank you very much. I wanted to visit with the council for a few minutes about some items that are occurring between the town of Frederick, the town of Firestone, the Frederick Fire Protection District, and the Mountain View Fire Protection District. As you know, or you may not know, the town of Frederick and the town of Firestone have been aggressively annexing portions along the 119 corridor, which currently the Mountain View Fire Protection District serves those areas. Part of that annexation requires that those people that get annexed into those communities become excluded, taken out of our district and put into the Frederick Fire Protection District. Our board has been dealing this with this for the last year or so, or actually it's been the last couple of years. But as a part of that, our board has recently denied the exclusion of those properties from our district to go into the Frederick Firestone district. As a result of that, the town of Frederick, the town of Firestone, and the Frederick Fire Protection District has filed lawsuits against the Mountain View Fire Protection District based on those exclusions. So at our last, we've been defending those lawsuits, obviously. But at our last board meeting, the board of directors of Mountain View Fire Protection District, and I'll just read this into the record if I may. As a result of those lawsuits, the board of directors of Mountain View Fire Protection District, as a result of a recent lawsuit filed by the town of Frederick, town of Firestone, the Frederick Fire Protection District against the Mountain View Fire Protection District regarding the exclusion of property currently within the Mountain View Fire boundaries, we believe it is in the best interest of our citizens to terminate an automatic aid agreement between the two fire districts and replace it with a mutual aid agreement between the two fire districts. Basically, an automatic aid agreement is, we have an agreement with the Frederick Fire District. If they need us for service or we need them for service for assistance, that it's, we have an agreement where when we get dispatched, their units are automatically dispatched with our units and vice versa. So as a result of this lawsuit, our board has determined to eliminate that agreement and replace it with a mutual aid agreement. A mutual aid agreement is simply our units, our responding units have to pick up the radio and just say we need assistance from Frederick Fire or vice versa, whether it's Frederick Fire or North Metro Fire or Thornton Fire or Burn Fire. So that's the difference between an automatic aid agreement and a mutual aid agreement. The district boards believe this will allow each the district board believes this will allow each district to make its own decision regarding how to handle emergency incidents within its jurisdiction and determine whether or not additional personnel or equipment apparatus is needed on a case-by-case basis. Therefore, should the Frederick Firestone Fire Protection District need assistance on an as-needed basis, Mountain View Fire will respond with the necessary equipment and personnel immediately when called. Alternatively, should the Mountain View Fire Protection District need assistance on an as-needed basis, it will contact the appropriate agencies to request an assistance. So if that's Frederick, we'll contact Frederick, which that's North Metro or another surrounding unit. If we need assistance, we'll make those calls. The Mountain View Fire Protection District believes it has taken reasonable steps to resolve the dispute outside of court or law. Mountain View Fire will continue to look for opportunities to invite the town of Frederick, the town of Firestone, and the Frederick Fire Protection District to negotiate an amicable resolution for each district and the communities they serve. So I just wanted to come this evening and assure the council, the residents of Dacono, that Mount View Fire Protection District is capable of providing those services. In the event that we do need assistance for major incidents, we will ensure that that assistance is available to the citizens of Dacono. So.
Never a doubt in my mind that, you know, you guys wouldn't be there for us, that's for sure. In my opinion, Mount View Fire is fantastic, you know, fire department. You know, I've had personal experiences, you know, last summer, you know. You guys came to my aid when it was needed. And like I said, and you guys are fantastic. You know, and I understand, between two special districts, you know, territory situation when someone starts moving in, starts cutting into, you know, funding. And yeah. So it's one of those things where, you know, and I believe Mount View is professional enough to not allow, you know, this to interfere with their day-to-day operations as well, so.
Yeah, the fire district board, the staff, and from the staff to the responders have taken every effort to keep this from affecting service to any of the communities we serve. But because of the relationship or the close proximity of the Frederick Firestone Fire District, I just want to assure this board and citizens of Dacono that we're more than capable of serving those needs, and we'll continue to do that. And we'll ensure that the protection is there should the citizens of Dacono call us.
We appreciate that.
And I'd be happy to answer any questions from council.
I know being in court, there's probably not a whole lot to really talk about, but you know, it's one of those things. I don't know all the loopholes or the, you know, stuff like that, and what kind of compromises you guys can even do, you know? Because I understand, you know, Frederick Firestone Fire wanting to take over that area, but I also understand Mount View was there first, you know? So it's one of those things. There's definitely a compromise there, probably. It's just a matter on what.
Yeah, and I think we've extended that offer as an organization. You know, unfortunately, at this time, I haven't elected to. To work with us, so.
Yeah, unless I know right now there we are. But like I said, I don't have no doubt service would be affected in any shape or form, so.
Thank you, and I just want to assure the council that it wouldn't be.
All right, well, thank you so much.
Thanks, Chief.
All right. Public comment on issues not scheduled on tonight's agenda. I know I saw a couple individuals sign up for that. So who would like to be the first? Richard's going to be the first? All right.
Yeah. State my name and all that? Yeah. Richard Kimball, 1209 McLaughlin Court, Dacono. I just had a question. I've been watching the newspaper and everything, and I don't know what the city plans on doing, or if they plan on not doing anything, or what. But the start of the year now is not too bad, but the skunks is going to be a situation coming up here before too long. It's getting to be where these skunks are rabid now. In fact, they just found one over in the Boulder area. They found two, three of them just up north here and everything. Up at Platteville, up in Evans and everything. So, you know, what can the city council and the people in the town do about this situation? Because if a cat or something gets hold of it, that cat becomes rabid, you know. And I don't, cat, dog, whatever. And I would just like for the city council to consider something to do about, you know, if it gets really prevalent, because sometimes you see up there in the blends, you'll see one going and here comes three little babies right along with them walking down the middle of the street.
I think if I remember right, a few years back we had addressed this same situation, I think it was, wasn't AJ?
I brought it up that one time when the city administrator Karen, about, you know, the skunk situation and everything. Now I would like to know, legally, can a person go out if they're in the backyard messing around? Can you shoot them?
Yeah,
I don't think you can, because you cannot discharge a weapon in the city limits.
And we'll tell you what we'll do is I'm definitely, yeah, definitely what I'm going to do is I'm going to have AJ look into this for us, see what, if there is a programs out there, because I know there's state falls into some of that stuff on some of these different wildlife stuff.
Yeah, usually that's Department of Wildlife issue. Okay. We'll give you some traps if you want to trap one.
Can I bring it to you to dispose of?
Well, no.
Well, why not?
We'll drop it off over to Joe's house.
Oh. Well, I was just wondering. I was just going to return the favor.
Okay, but yeah, we can.
Thanks, Richard.
Okay.
I just had a comment. One of the things to help keep skunks and raccoons and things down is to not put cat food, dog food outside. If you have any cats or dogs, please feed them inside or feed them on a timed period so that, you know, they eat, you pick up the food. But if you have that food out in your yard, in your backyard, you're just asking for wildlife to come in and eat it.
I don't have cats or dogs, but there's a lot of the, what do you call, feral cats around again and everything. So that's one thing I was wondering about. You know, one time we kind of, well, I don't suppose you could say eradicated, but spayed and everything, and it cut down on the population of them a lot and everything. But they're starting to get more of them again and everything, so. Like I said, I'm worried about the situation. I got grandkids that come up and you know, stay with me and my wife and everything. And I don't want a cat. You know, they're young, and I don't want them to go playing with a cat that comes across that, you know, stray or whatever. They usually, you know, will run from a person, but I don't want to take the chance on them being bitten and not knowing, because you're not going to be able to quarantine a feral rabbit, you know, a feral cat. You play catching them. So I would just like the council to start, you know, think something about it, consider it.
Yeah, we'll definitely look into something different, you know, things that, you know, preventative to try to deter them as well, too, so.
All right,
we'll look
you.
Into it. Mm-hmm. All right.
Clyde Calder, 303 Glen Eyre, Dacono. I have a few questions, and if any of you can answer them tonight, I'd appreciate it. And if you can't, get me help later. First of all, who do we call when we see water running down the street in the middle of the day since we're on restrictions? I don't know who to call when I see it running down the street and the whole intersection full of water.
You just call right down here to City Hall and talk to...
Police department?
Yeah. Oh, okay.
And talk to code enforcement or anyone that answers the phone, police department.
Okay, thank you. My backyard butts up against 4th Street, and kids skateboard on it, kids ride bikes on it, families walk on it, which I think is wonderful. And I know we all love the BMX track, and I do too, because it's done wonderful things for Dacona and the youth. But the nights that we have practice and racing on Tuesdays and Wednesdays and weekends, we have a speed problem. I'm sure Brian's heard lots about it. The thing I wondered, when we used to have the four-way stop, at least it slowed them down. Why did we go back to a two-way?
Well, I'll have to get back to you on that one.
Okay. Slow them down. And when they put out the big sign with the speeding thing, they slow down for that, but as soon as the sign's taken away, it's just... But I'm just afraid somebody's going to really, really get hurt because, and I realize they're anxious to get up there and they probably don't, I don't think anybody's doing it intentionally. It's just a nice, straight, paved way and they go. And I thought, well, I'd ask at least, because I know when we used to have the four-way, they had to slow down, you know, to get to the stop signs. And all of a sudden we went to a two-way.
Yeah. I believe one of the reasons why was it because people were blowing through that anyway. People weren't stopping going north-south, and so people would try and, you know, stop the other way, and then they think they go, and they just kind of blow right through. So we tried to eliminate the accident situation within the intersection.
So you feel like leaving it a two-way is probably the best option?
Oh, I'm not sure. We haven't done traffic counts or warrant studies on that.
Okay. The other thing I wanted to ask about is the weeds and the messy yards. I know that our code officer is snowed under, but I noticed lately up in the glens and the town of Dacono, we have a lot of yards that are really not good. I know you wouldn't give them a Pride of Dacono thing. Probably you'd give them a Shame of Dacono if you give those out. But I don't know.
We have those. They're called summons to court.
Oh, okay. Well, evidently they're not working in some areas because sometimes the yards just keep going. And I don't know.
If you definitely have addresses, let us know, and we'll step in and look at it.
Well, the thing I wondered is, once they give them a warning, how long do they have, and do they follow through, and does it happen? Some of them, I think, they just are repeaters.
Repeat customers, absolutely.
And I realize that a lot of them are rentals, and then you have to do the lien thing, and that's drug out. Yeah. But I just wanted to mention that it's starting out kind of trashy this year.
Okay, I'll give you my card. You give me those addresses, and we'll take care of it.
And what time of the day and night can I call you?
Well, I'll give you my office number. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Okay.
And there'll be an answering machine right there to pick that up.
Okay. The other thing I wanted to ask is, when does the mosquito spraying start? I noticed this morning when I was out working in the yard, they're really fired up and ready to go. So I was curious what the program is this year. Do we still call a number?
Same as last year, same number, yeah.
Okay.
They've already been out doing larvicide. I don't know that, just due to weather conditions with rain, it's kind of stopped lately. I don't think they've done the spraying yet, the adult size.
So will that be in our letters again with the water bills so that we know who to call? Okay.
Yeah, we can put that in there for sure, if it's not already.
Well, thanks, guys, for listening, and thanks for the answers.
Thank you. Is there any other public comments on issues not scheduled on tonight's agenda? All right, seeing none. All right, we are now to our consent agenda, which consists of the minutes of the May 13, 2013 regular meeting, accounts payable dated June 10, 2013, approval of resolution 13-20, approving the third amendment to subdivision improvement agreement for garage units, and approval of resolution 13-22, approving the revised employment agreement for A.J. Euchre and the city administrator. Council, what would you like to do with these particular items?
Move to approve consent agenda as presented.
Yeah, motion made by Baker.
Second.
Seconded by Randolph. Can I receive a vote, please?
Jen Schneider.
Yes.
Kevin Plain.
Yes.
Joe Baker.
Yes.
Peggy Randolph.
Yes.
Steve Bruno.
Yes.
That motion carries with all voting yes. And now to our general business. Just let everybody know there is a misprint on their general business. Item A is a public hearing. So, first item under general business is resolution, public hearing for resolution 13-21, considering the proposed industrial use permit for 5445 Colorado Boulevard. So at this time, I open the public hearing and turn it over to Jennifer.
Mayor and Council, this is the public hearing for City Council Resolution 13-21 approving an industrial use for extreme drilling. As you are all familiar with, none of the industrial uses in the City of Dacono are permitted by right, and they all require industrial use approval by the City Council. The public hearing tonight is 5445 Colorado Boulevard. It is also known as Lot 2A Grand Divide Business Park. In your packet this evening, you do have several exhibits showing the location of the site. The land is currently zoned industrial and has been used for industrial uses since the subdivision of plat was approved in 2000. Many of you may know this as the former site of GE Landscaping, and most recently Black and Gold Asphalt along Colorado Boulevard. The proposed use this evening is for office maintenance of equipment, minor equipment fabrication, and outside storage of vehicles and equipment which are used to support field operations for extreme drilling. The applicant is here this evening and will go into further detail about the operations of the business. In your packet this evening, and all these items should be entered into the record, you do have a staff report, the application, several photos that were submitted by the applicant to show the types of equipment that is used for the operations of the business, as well as the Dacono Municipal Code, should also be entered into the record. As I indicated, the parcel is located in Grand Divide Business Park, which is an approved industrial park. The lot size is 10 acres. The proposed use is, again, the standard of review for these uses is if the use is offensive to occupants of surrounding properties by way of emission or creation of excessive noise, vibration, odor, dust, other particulate matter, or storage of hazardous materials. For this particular application, we did contact the Mountain View Fire regarding the storage of any type of hazardous materials. They weren't concerned about, or overly concerned, I should say, about any hazardous materials stored on the site, and they will add the use, if approved, to their regular inspection for occupancy. Based on the previous uses, staff finds that the site is appropriate for industrial uses. It's a very large site with industrial uses on both the north and the south side. It is adequately screened, and staff finds, based on the application, staff recommends approval. And I should also mention that the Planning and Zoning Commission did recommend approval of the proposed industrial use at their public hearing on May 14th, 2013. Are there any questions?
I guess the one question I would have is, I see some of the equipment here is a helicopter. Will those be trucked in or flown in?
They will be trucked in. There's okay. Not a provision for a helipad on the site, but mm-hmm. Again, the applicant can go into more detail about the equipment and uses.
Is there any questions for Jennifer at this time, Council?
Yeah. Was there any concern about the cleaning of equipment on that site and any kind of residue or anything that might be washed into the soil? I mean, did that get figured out or?
At the Planning and Zoning Commission, there was some discussion as to what, if any, types of chemicals will be in the equipment and how will the equipment be washed, whether it be some kind of an improved pad for equipment washing and if it'll be filtered into the sanitary sewer, or if it'll be just rinsed off on site and percolate into the ground. Again, I'll refer that to the applicant to go into further detail about equipment washing and how that will be handled and where it will be handled and any kind of improvements that they will provide with that equipment washing.
Okay. Would the applicant wish to speak? I'm going to have you do is come on up. I have to have you say your name, be sworn, and give your address as well.
Good evening. My name is Mike Murray, managing partner of Extreme Drilling.
And your address?
7636 Road 10, Fort Lupton.
Please raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give before the Dacono City Council will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing?
I do.
Thank you.
Questions?
Just the cleaning, which is referred to you about the apparatuses that you're going to be cleaning on site. I think there was some concern raised as to any of the remnants left over onto the apparatuses spilling onto or going into the ground soil.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
The type of equipment, it's small portable drilling equipment for seismograph oil and gas exploration. We drill holes in the dirt, basically, so it gets dirty, and then it's powered by small diesel engines in the 70 to 80 horsepower range. So, you know, anytime you're throwing dirt in the air, things get dirty and equipment gets run pretty hard. And we're not working in, we won't be working here. We work all over the country, Alaska, remote areas. So, for maintenance purposes, you know, like anything, we bring stuff home and it doesn't have wheels on it. Everything is airlifted with helicopters. Majority of my equipment, so it's important that we wash it, to inspect it, and just for overall maintenance, you know, and same with our vehicles. We have a fleet of about 20 to 30 pickups trailers and, you know, stuff just gets dirty and we need to keep stuff clean and to perform proper inspection and maintenance. So, and we did address the pressure washing with the local fire department in the area here, and they basically deferred to city council to give recommendations when permits are going to be pulled, and you know what basically give to us what options there would be out there to install the proper type of setup to perform general cleaning and washing and stuff. So,
I'm pretty familiar with the property. I know along Colorado Boulevard, there's quite a bit of screening already along there. If I remember right, there's like some vine or something like that that's on the chain link fencing that's in front of it.
Yeah, exactly.
My question, I guess, is screening for the rear of the property that backs to the Legacy Trail there. Last time I recall, there was somewhat of a fence, I guess.
There's no fence there, no. There's a row of trees that have been planted there and a berm. But for security, we would want to, three sides are chain link fencing. We would definitely need to, fence that in there and for security reasons. So.
And when you're doing the maintenance on your vehicle, on the vehicles and stuff like that, are you going to be putting up any type of additional sheds? Because if I recall, there's no shop on this.
There's no shop. We're planning on putting up we're looking at like 100 by 120 by 80, I think it is, or 120 by or 140 by 80, a steel building, perform all our maintenance indoors and stuff, and there's adequate storage outside for. I do have quite a bit of pieces of equipment and stuff, and various times of the year, certain types of equipment is gone. Anywhere from 2 weeks to 2 or 3 months, we could be. We just recently finished a big project on the tundra up in Alaska, and in the interior, we were up there for 3 or 4 months, so. That equipment is back, and other equipment's heading to Wyoming next week. So we just, and we're typically gone for, like I said, anywhere from 2 to 3 months, two weeks to 3 months. Projects vary in size and scope. So
The reason for my line of questioning is, say Dacono, we have been working pretty hard to improve our image.
Yep.
And that we want to make sure we just don't have another storage facility, that's got, in this case, drills up on blocks that you can see from Boulevard, a building that, just a pop-up shed, canvas type buildings, things like that. Yeah. So like I said, we're working very hard to set our bar up here and to continue moving the city forward. So that's the reasoning for the line of my questioning.
Well, we're, going to be putting out a sizable investment into this property, so we, looking at the future as well, we don't want to put lipstick on a pig, so to speak, so we're going to want to do it right, so.
See, and unfortunately, the thing is you're kind of tied in between two properties that aren't the highest maintained. Well, you're right next door to Stair Cycle there, so, but on the other side, you got whole bunch of other stuff.
Yeah,
it's not quite.
Yeah, I mean, you talk about visibility, and you talk about it matching the flavor of the environment.
Yeah, exactly.
You're going to have steel things up on blocks to the south at Steel Star, and you're going to have tractor trailers to the north at Stair Cycle. And if the idea is to look at encouraging fencing and that sort of thing, either way, I think it fits in well with the existing businesses.
We're oil field service, and that can be misconstrued to what we do, there's a lot of junky looking oil field equipment out here that, as you very well know, this is a hot area for oil, for oil production right now, and ours is, it's a very specialized type of equipment. It's all relatively small, just like the helicopter, if it's going to be parked at this facility, it's thing only weighs like 3,000 pounds. You know, it bigger than a. It's most fifth wheel campers are bigger than this unit. You know, but it's very rarely in the area, and sometimes it just needs a place to park for a while in between jobs. It's based out of Minden, Nevada, so it's a long haul to take it home if we're going to be working in the area, you know. So,
well, you're losing money if it's parked there, basically. So, I mean, if it's not out actually doing something,
right,
it's just
right,
sitting
yeah,
there.
Yeah, we just soon everything be it just be a big empty lot, but unfortunately, that's not going to be the case most of the time. So. Questions for the applicant?
All right, Gina, thank you so much for coming out.
Thanks.
Is there anyone from the public that wishes to speak on this matter? Okay, seeing none. So at this time, I close the public hearing and turn it back over to the council for further discussion or a motion.
Motion to approve considerations for approval, excuse me. For resolution 1321, considering a proposal industrial use permit for 5445 Colorado Boulevard.
Second.
All right, we have a motion made by Baker, second by Snyder. Can I receive a vote, please?
Kevin Plain?
Yes.
Joe Baker?
Yes.
Peggy Randolph?
Yes.
Steve Bruno?
Yes.
Jen Schneider?
Yes.
Okay, that motion carries, all voting yes. Welcome to Dacono.
Thank you.
All right. Now, our next item of business this evening is the appointment of our new city council member. Val, if I can have you give us a couple little sheets of paper. We do it with a silent vote here.
Official ballots.
Official ballot, that's it.
Official post-it notes?
Yep.
This is one of the rare times where the mayor gets to vote.
I know, I feel special tonight here. Okay.
We vote for ourselves, right?
Only once.
Only if you want to be removed.
Interviews were held right before this meeting. All the candidates were here. They were all interviewed. And council is now voting on their top choice.
Give her that.
Can you share that up so you vote twice?
No, you'll see. Torn in half.
And then before Val reads the official. I want to thank each and everybody for coming out that showed interest in the Dacono City Council. You know, we had a very, very difficult choice to make this evening because every one of you would have been perfect for the position. So keep that in mind. You know, I wish we could have put all four of you on here, but fortunately, that's just not possible. Okay, what'd you do?
I put my name in there and she just gave me the look.
You heard what it said. We'll see you. So we got next year opening. Joe just wound up.
I just want to see if Val's paying attention. That's all.
So the runner up gets Joe.
Yeah.
I'm going to butcher his last name, but Eric Hakemeester.
Okay.
That's your guy.
All right. Well, thank you so much. Congratulations to. How do you say his name? Well, does Eric?
Hakemeester.
Okay, once he's actually here, I'll be able to have him help break that down for us in a little bit. But yeah, like I said, thank you so much for all coming out on that. We do appreciate that. But don't forget, there's a lot of other opportunities to become council members. So, all right, with that. Appointment there. Do we need to vote on that? Or, no, well, we already did vote on it. Never mind. But need to do something a little more official? Or?
I need to swear my money here.
I swear him in. All right. So next meeting.
I'll follow up with him and just get him all the administrative things, get that going, talk with Kelly and work on his tablet and let him know about the schedule.
Who's the one coming back from
he's the purchase buyout after.
Okay. All right. Next item, we have no more general business this evening. We're going to go ahead and go to staff reports. I'm going to turn that over to AJ.
This is the only official city meeting this week. We're going to have our work session, very brief work session right after this, downstairs. And then this Saturday, we have our first annual citywide garage sale. We have some very good interest about that. And that just, the city kind of markets that. The people come and sign their address up. We put out a list and have cool looking signs you can put out in front of your yard so everybody knows. And so that takes place this Saturday. And Jennifer, can we still take addresses or is that cut off?
Sure.
We can still take some addresses. Next week is the CML annual conference in Vail. Everybody should have your confirmations and travel arrangements and emails and all that. And I'll get you the final breakdown. I know we have lunch from United Power as well. And I'm not sure if the Veterans Park Committee will meet next week, given that elected officials and pretty much all every community in the area won't be here. So we can look at either canceling or postponing that. The next meeting is the regular council meeting on the 24th. And we have a lot of items up for that. So that's all I have, just some scheduling at this point.
I went to two events this last couple weeks that were pretty interesting. One was just women of Weld County, Democratic women of Weld County, and we were talking about all the different opportunities that are out there. So if anybody is interested in positions, they would definitely be the people to talk to for elected positions. The other thing I went to was Senator Udall was holding a work session for women to talk about women's issues and things he could bring up in the Senate and the issues that we thought were pertinent. And there was quite a few women there, and it was very productive.
So. Any other council report? Well, I want to thank everybody that came out for the Dacono cleanup. That's great to see that participation there. I hear Jen, you got first place in that too.
Yeah.
Would you like to share? What was your interesting item?
I had three of them. I think we ended up saying that one was a print planing blade, and a very old railroad spike. And it was myself, my mother, and my two children then. We're doing the legacy trail there.
Nice. Well, thank you for being involved on that. And also another reminder, it's getting hotter out there. Watch the watering, I know it's tough right now. I've got plenty of yards that are burning up right now. Key thing is keep them cut long, but keep them groomed. That's the main thing there. But with that note, I have no other reports. Like I said, we're all heading to CML next week, so look forward to having some pretty good updates when we get back on that. So, fantastic. Once again, thanks to all the candidates that came out tonight. So, with that, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. Motion made by Baker, second by Bruno. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.